when temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Good morning. Oh my. Good morning. Hi. Who said hi? Hi, Christina. Welcome to First Christian Church. Hi. Okay. We're so glad you're here this morning. Your presence is everything. We are going to join in worship together in just a minute. If you would, there are some slips on your on the tables and in the backs of the chairs. If you are visiting with us today, we would love to know more about you. Feel free to fill those out and place them in the offering plates at the front or on the stations on the side here. If you have a prayer request, we have an intercessory prayer team that meets on Thursdays at noon. And feel free to write that on that paper as well. Everyone can do that. And they will pray for you this week, whatever your need may be. Are there any other announcements this morning? Jillian, you have anything? No. Yay. All right. So let's have all the children age 8 and under go with Miss Jillian to children's worship. I need more coffee, don't you think? Miriam has an announcement. I'm going to let you come say something about homecoming. Today is homecoming, y'all.
Which Milton Dale is preaching, has the sermon this morning. So you won't hear Jacob twice. You can come on to both services, and then you can, you won't hear the same sermon. I go anyway both times, but anyway, after the 11 o'clock service, we'll come back in here. Milton, somebody will have the prayer. Whatever that last prayer is blessing your food, so you just come on in and we'll have the spread out, okay? And if you don't want to stay for the 11 o'clock, come back at 12. We need people to eat. We got plenty, plenty food. Thank you.
I don't know about y'all, but I can eat. So, yeah, come on back at noon and eat. And in the meantime, let's stand and praise our God together.
There's revival and it's spreading. Good morning. Great to see you this morning. What brought y'all here in the rain and the yuck, other than homecoming? This wonderful band, wonderful music. What? You had to fix communion. That's why you're here. Well, and you. Regardless of why you think you're here, you are here by divine appointment. I hope we never take for granted this opportunity that we have to be here in this space together. And I'm glad that you all made the sacrifice to be here this morning. This is one of those mornings where certainly it would be easy to, well, you wouldn't want to turn on the news, would you? But certainly, as I say often, and it is so very true, Hallmark movies, are they already playing Christmas? They start Friday. Valerie will not like that. But honestly, there are a number of things you could have done this morning, and I imagine many of you had the impulse to do something else. But you are here, and I want to thank you for being here. For some of you, there's no place you would rather be than right here. But as I say, for all of us, we really are here by divine appointment. God can speak to us in any number of ways. There was a time I was working with a special needs children's group. It was a residential treatment center, and I attended a church where on that particular Sunday, there was a minister who was a minister in training. He happened to be from the United Methodist tradition, and he had gone to one of their assemblies, and he came back to give the report, and that was going to be the sermon for the day. And he read his report word for word for word, and it went on and on and on and on. And the minister's mic was on. The minister of the church was sitting behind him, and he fell asleep and was snoring into the microphone. And I thought, what a waste of time this was. And the kids were antsy. And then the minister stood up and he said something seemingly unrelated to other things, but he said, "We work for God, but we work with people." And that was a message I actually needed to hear that day. Honestly, that was a word from God. I was working with some situations that I thought, come on now, people, pull your weight in a situation. And sometimes we need to be reminded that wherever we are, whatever situation we're in, our service is to God. And, you know, some people look at us, too, and say, I work for God, but I'm having to work with Jacob. And that could be you, that could be me. But my point of sharing that with you is God can speak to us in any number of ways at a time that can surprise us. For some of us, we think we're going to hear a word through a message. For some of us, we know. If it's Jacob, we're not going to hear a word through the message, but we'll hear a word through a song. We'll hear a word through a prayer. We'll hear a word through something that someone will say at the communion table. Sometimes it's a word you'll exchange between one another for having been here, but it can be something that you needed to hear at that moment. And so what I would invite you to do along with me is for us to open our hearts and our minds for what God may say to us in perhaps a surprising way, that we would invite God to say what God wants to say to us, and that we can invite God to speak to us as it pleases God to speak. So I invite you to go to God in prayer with me now. Gracious God, we are indeed grateful to be here this morning. We thank you for the very ability to be here. For some of us, we drove here in vehicles that are a gift in itself. For some of us, we walked here. For some of us, we got a good night's sleep last night. For others of us, we were restless. We were restless perhaps because you were stirring us, and for some of us, we were restless because of the anxiety that goes on within us. We are here for many and varied reasons, but we are also here for a common purpose. We're here to celebrate you. We're here to welcome you. Whether we recognize it or not, we are here to encounter you. Whether we think we came on our own volition, by our own will, help us to see that we are truly not here by accident or coincidence. We invite you to speak to us as it pleases you to speak. We invite you to transform our minds as it pleases you to transform us. We pray for a renewed ability and capacity to see ourselves as you see us. Help us to see one another as you see us. Help us to see our loved ones as you see them. Help us to see our perceived enemies as you see them. Help us to grow in the knowledge of who you truly are. Help us to transcend the categories that we've placed you in. We invite you to deliver us from narrow ways of thinking, from narrow ways of understanding who's included within your love. Give us a glimpse, even a glimpse, of your infinite love, your powerful love that truly is power. The power that sets us free from fear. The power that sets us free from hate. The power that sets us free from the violence that we do to ourselves, the violence that we do to others. Recognizing that violence is not merely physical. It's whatever distorts or diminishes the image that you have placed within each one of us, your divine image. Turn our hearts of stone into hearts of compassion. Help us to see our brothers and sisters' needs as our needs. Help us, like Jesus, to embody your love, to break down the barriers that separate us, to take the initiative even as Jesus did, to have the urgency of Paul, to share your grace with as many people as possible, as quickly as possible, to have the boldness of the women who showed up at the tomb, the women who walked with Jesus to the very end when the men disciples scattered, the women who were the first to announce that Jesus is risen. Give us confidence, O God. Give us trust. Empower us to empty ourselves so that you can fill us. That you can fill us with your love, your peace, and your light. So that we can be a beacon to a world in desperate need of hope. Recognizing that the light does not come from us. That others, as they look to us, they will not see us. But they'll see your light shining through us. This we ask in the name of the one who truly is the way, the truth, and the life. The one who taught us to pray when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite those who are serving to come forward. For those of you who are here each week, you know that every person here is welcome, but not every person here recognizes that each person is welcome. So church, who is welcome here? Everyone. Let's say it with a little more enthusiasm so they know it. Who's welcome here, church? Everyone is welcome here. Doesn't mean that you're just welcome to sit at a table. It doesn't mean that you're welcome just to participate in the food and receive some of the food and coffee. Doesn't mean that you're welcome just to attend here. It means you are welcome in the life of this congregation. You are welcome to celebrate communion. And you're welcome to celebrate communion because it's not mine to offer. It's not this church's to offer. It's not the denomination's welcome to offer. The invitation comes from Jesus, and Jesus welcomes all. We are reminded, fortunately, because we need to be reminded, because in our own minds and the number of things that our attention gets distracted toward would tell us that we are anything but a child of God. For sometimes we look around our world and it looks like a God-forsaken world. We look around at violence. We look at people being territorial, nations being territorial. We see people willing to kill one another over what they believe. Jesus was willing to die for what he believed, but he wasn't willing to kill for it. And in so doing, he revealed the greatest power in the world, that power doesn't come from weapons. Power doesn't come from bombs. Power doesn't come from guns. Not power properly understood. Power is the ability to achieve purpose. And God's purpose is to restore and reconcile. Only love can do that. Love is anything but weak. Love cannot be reduced to a sentimental emotion. It was love that caused Jesus to say, "Not my will, but your will be done." Did Jesus think that the Father willed crucifixion? Mm-mm. God the Creator willed perfect love all the way to the end, no matter what. The power to look around when his disciples were sleeping, when he asked them just to pray for a little while. The power in that upper room, knowing what was ahead. The power when those crowds that a few days earlier had been saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna," started shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." The power to witness to that love no matter what, so that the power of the resurrection could be revealed. Love is eternal. So when we come to celebrate communion, we're celebrating the incarnation, the embodiment of love, and the life that flowed through that body in the cup. That's what that means, the life. We too begin to embody that love. We too grow in that life. We have an opportunity for those of us who need it. And sometimes it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. We have a prayer station. We remember that Christ, the light of the world, shines in the darkness, and the darkness will never, ever overcome it. And then we have an opportunity for those of us who are able, for those of us who have been called to contribute with our financial resources. You have already given sacrificially by being here this morning, and I want to thank you for that. A number of you have given of your time each week. Those members that gather on that stage, they practice each week and they sacrifice their time. And those who prepare these meals, and those who work in that technology booth, and those who prepare the communion, and so much goes into this so that we can have this experience together. We give in so many ways. For many of you, you are giving to a family or loved one, sacrificing your own trajectory that you had plans for your life, and now you're called to give love to someone who needs you. What a wonderful calling. What a wonderful ministry. It probably won't show up in a footnote of a book, but shows up in the kingdom of heaven. It's celebrated by God. Many of you are giving in ways you don't even realize. And God is so pleased with you, and sometimes you feel like you're not doing enough. And I pray for you that you'll have a touch from God saying, "I appreciate you. I know what you're going through. I know how hard it is." But we have an opportunity for those who are called this morning, if you would feel called to contribute financially. That too is a gift from God to be able to give, and we celebrate that, and there's no shame if you can't. However God is calling you to respond, we invite you to do so in the moments that follow.
Every Sunday when we gather, it's a blessing to be able to have communion. I was sitting there, and I kept looking at the front of the table. This do in remembrance of me. To remember him, to remember the sacrifices that Jesus made for us, dying on the cross, giving his life for us. It's such a blessing because it led us to his salvation. It led us to be able to be here each Sunday and partake of this bread and partake of this cup in remembrance of him. This cup is his blood, and this bread his body broken. to us once we take communion each week, the minutes leading up to our prayers for it, the actual act of eating the bread and drinking the cup. It renews our body, renews our soul. So please pray with me. Dear Lord, we ask for blessings on this bread. May it bless everyone that partakes of it this Sunday and every day that your body is broken for us. And Lord, may this blood refresh our soul and lead us to do your work. On that day that he gathered with his disciples, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave thanks for it. This is my body broken for you. Likewise, he took that cup of wine, he rose, and he said, this is my blood shed for you for your salvation. Let us remember. This table is for all. Come and partake.
Thank you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you
I did not know which direction I was going to go this week until, Chip, was it Thursday? Thursday. I received, it was a text message with a screenshot of a scripture reading that I had been considering, as it turns out, for a few days in terms of direction. Do you have your outlines with you? Because we're going to go through a lot of scripture readings today. And we're going to deal with the topic that, ironically, I don't know that I've ever dealt with or heard a lot of mainline ministers deal with directly. How many times can you remember in a mainline congregation hearing about salvation, just generally speaking, dealing with salvation, what it means? Not a lot. It's one of those subjects that we avoid, I guess. I'm not sure why that is. Maybe it's because different people have different takes on salvation, but I was thinking about doing that, and it's interesting because it wasn't that I was nervous, I just recognized that this topic can be potentially controversial. It can upset people. And I was wondering if we wanted to tackle this week, and when I received this screenshot, I realized this is the direction to go. And then this special music today, I had not communicated with the people that need to receive some communication with me. I'm the first domino that falls sometimes. In other words, when there's a direction, then that kind of sets off a chain of events that affects music and other things of that nature. But this morning, we are going to talk about salvation. And the reason I ask if you saw your handout is because that is actually the screenshot I received. And I just copied and pasted it because I felt like this was a nudge in the direction. Now, that credit I give Chip. Anything I say from here on is not his responsibility, okay? Don't blame him for what I'm getting ready to say. I probably will challenge some of your assumptions about salvation and what it means. And we're going to look at a number of different sources, and we're going to move through this relatively quickly. It's not often that I direct your attention to a number of different scripture readings, because in my preparation to become a communicator of the message of Jesus, we were taught that to do so is considered proof texting. Proof texting is when you start with a conclusion in mind and then you go looking for a bunch of different scripture readings to support your perspective, your conviction. How many of you know that that's what most people tend to do? They begin with their foregone conclusion about something, and then they'll go look at Scripture, and they'll find Scripture passages to reinforce their preconceived notion about a particular matter. What I'm getting ready to do, in many ways, is the opposite of that. Because we say that we believe thus and so, many people in this room would say, I believe the Bible is the only source of authority to which we turn to find our answers about what it means to be a Christian, what it means to be a person of faith. For some people, they say the Bible is the only source. You've heard me say, literally since day one that we were together, that there are at least four sources, and I go to a fifth. So I want you all to tell me what those four are, and if one of you knows the fifth, then you will win a 4-day, 3-night cruise of your desire, of your choosing. What are the four sources? We've already named one. Bible, tradition, / history, experience, reason, community. She won the cruise, Doris. Wow. And you've heard me say that our experience does not determine, but it's difficult to overstate, the degree to which our experience conditions the way we read Scripture, the way we survey history, if we do it all, and the way we think, our reason, our experience, sometimes rooted in a family of origin, oftentimes rooted in a particular culture. How many of you know that rural areas tend to be more evangelical than urban? Why would that be? Because our experience shapes the way we think. There's nothing wrong with being rural. There's nothing wrong with being from an urban area. But what we need to see is our experience shapes the way we think. How many of you are lifelong disciples? Raise your hand if you would, please. About a third of you. How many of you disciples believe that DOC is the best denomination out there? Raise your hand. If you've been a disciple your whole life, how do you know? How many of you have been Christians your whole life? Raise your hand. How many of you have seriously engaged another religion? Raise your hand. A few of you. For those of you who haven't, how do you know that Christianity is the right one? Have I messed with your minds enough yet? So we say, how do we then grow in our understanding? How do we grow beyond our limited experience? The reason I say community is it's important to engage people whose experience is different than our own. Otherwise, we wind up surrounding ourselves with people who think just the same way we do. And then what happens? Our perspective gets reinforced. And then what happens? Potentially, not necessarily, but potentially, we begin to deem our perspective as superior to others. What is the opportunity to bridge community, to strengthen community, to extend community, if we have a whole bunch of groups who think their way is superior to others? That's right. It's important to engage with other groups. Now, for many of us, we say either the Bible is the sole authority of how we understand who God is, who Jesus was, who we're called to be. For some of us, we say it's primary. And for some of us, we recognize that there are a number of different sources. Now, I want to ask you this too, but don't raise your hand on this. It does not require a PhD in theology to engage any of those three sources that I named. The first three, our experience. We don't have to have access to a formal theological education to survey our history. We don't have to have a formal theological education to consult different sources on even how to read the Bible. We don't have to have a formal education to begin to think in different ways. But if I were to ask you, how many of you seriously engage the Bible? Seriously. Seriously engage the witness we've inherited up to this point with all of its twists and turns. How many of you have seriously engaged the thoughts of others? I wonder how many of us would raise our hands. So how is it then we can expect to live wisely? To live out this faith journey wisely. I'm not shaming you, I'm just saying, if we're going to do this, let's do this, right? We say that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and we proclaim him as Lord and Savior. But I believe that all too often we make that confession of faith as something like a superstitious claim, that if we make that claim, then we go to heaven, and now we're saved. Is that what Jesus was up to? Is that why Jesus came? So people would say his name, and then they'd go to heaven? Let me ask you this. How many of you remember the day you got saved? How many of you don't remember a day you got saved, but you would say it's just been an unfolding over time? Both of those experiences. And some of you may wonder, maybe I never got saved. I don't know if I'm saved. What does it mean to be saved? Let me share with you a couple of experiences. Does everybody have an outline, by the way? If not, I have several. Raise your hand if you don't have one. I'm happy to get you one. Everybody has one? You need one? Tasha? Anybody else? All right, I want to share with you an experience. I was once coming back from a wedding. I don't know why that's relevant, it's not. But I happened to be, I was coming through a major intersection. It was a relatively large city, and there was a guy with a bullhorn standing at the corner yelling things at people, essentially about get saved or go to hell. Have you ever encountered that before? How many people do you think get saved that way? And so I had, at this point, had an experience with God, and for whatever reason, it flew all over me. And I decided to pull over. And I walked up to him, and I was serious. I said, what is it you want to accomplish by doing this? And he walked me back to his vehicle, and he opened his trunk, and he had all these tracts. Have you ever seen those tracts? People hand you these tracts about the plan of salvation. And sometimes they show two cliffs and a big chasm in between. Have you seen this one? And Jesus is the bridge. And if you don't confess him, what happens? Not just pew. What happens? Eternal torment with fire exponentially hotter than any fire on earth. Am I the only one that's ever heard this? You've heard this. Does that get people saved? Because what does that set up in people's minds? That a God will torment you for eternity if you don't believe something. Now, we saw this last week. Can you will yourself to believe something? Maybe. But what happens is, if we don't actually believe it, we set up something within ourselves where we know we've lied to ourselves about something we don't actually believe. And we've lied to God about something we don't actually believe. And that does something to our souls, actually. You can't lie to yourself and keep that up without it affecting you adversely. And so we say, well, look to the Bible for salvation. We're going to look at that in just a moment. So what is salvation? What are we saved from? What are we saved for? How are we saved? There's a whole doctrine behind that that I share with you some weeks ago about salvation. Hey, buddy, check out his shoes. Those are some cool shoes. Soteriology is a doctrine of salvation. It's a formal understanding. Now, people have been arguing and debating. There have been controversies over how we are saved, how the cross saves us. Atonement theologies. There's substitutionary atonement. There are ransom theories, or doctrines, let's call them. How does the cross save us? Who was it directed toward? Some people say it was directed toward the devil because this is the domain. The world is the domain of the devil. And so God sent his son to pay off the devil because it was going to take a divine son. This was an early understanding among Greek patristics, Greek fathers. These were their way of starting to work out this theology after Jesus had gone. There were the churches that were beginning to spread, and now they were having to create this system because they thought that Jesus was coming back any day now, physically. And so they started working out these doctrines. And so how is it that Jesus saves us? And so in that culture, in that context, this is the domain of the devil, and so Jesus was a ransom. And that's what we see in part in this passage. Let's look at the passage. The one that was copied and pasted, it says, verse of the day, 1 Timothy 2, 5 through 6. He wants not only us, but everyone saved. You know, everyone to get to know the truth we've learned. That there's one God and only one, and one priest, mediator between God and us, Jesus, who offered himself in exchange for everyone held captive by sin, to set them all free. Eventually, this news is going to get out. This and this only has been my appointed work, getting this news to those who have never heard of God and explaining how it works by simple and plain truth. That's ransom. That's one translation. Another says ransomed us, bought back. So Jesus was the one who was willing to pay the price toward the devil. So the devil was the one that was changed and we were released, but it was directed toward the devil. That's what the sacrifice was about. It was the price paid to the devil to release us. I see a lot of you going, that is weird for 21st century ears, isn't it? For many. The one that most of us are familiar with is that it satisfied God's justice. God is both just and loving. This is what most of us inherited, and we thought it was the only one. We are part of a Protestant tradition. The Protestant Reformation did not take place until the 16th century. The understanding most of us have did not come along until 1,500 years after Jesus had died. But most of us reared in a particular culture thought it was the only one, because we're Protestants. That's what we heard. Limited experience. So it goes like this. God is both just, perfectly just, and loving. And so, in order for God to forgive us, there has to be a price that is paid. Justice, from a European context at that time, meant a punishment was required. And so they interpreted the cross as a punishment necessary to satisfy God's justice so that we could be forgiven. That's how many of us understand it. So what that does, though, that means then that love has to satisfy God's justice and not the other way around. Do you see how that works? Love had to satisfy God's justice rather than justice satisfying God's love. So one was directed at the devil, one was directed at God. There's another understanding, that it was directed toward us. God didn't change God's mind. God has never changed God's mind. This is my particular perspective. The crucifixion changed our minds. And in so doing, we are saved. Not because we're afraid that God is going to punish us if we don't believe in God. We are saved because we recognize just how much God loves us. And once we recognize that, there's nothing left to fear. Fear of God, fear of ourselves, fear of one another. Fear that there's not enough. Fear that I'm not enough. Fear that I'm not a somebody. And so now I have to accumulate things that say I'm a somebody. Now I have to rise in status that says I'm a somebody. Now I've got to identify with the group that is a somebody. Those are somebody, so I've got to identify with them. Now I've got to hoard resources because they may run out. I'm afraid. You see how this works? And now you've got a society where there are somebodies and nobodies, where resources are hoarded by some, and basic necessities are not enjoyed by those who desperately need them. And yet, so often we reduce salvation to a confession of faith that gets us into heaven. But that wasn't Jesus' primary concern, was it? He came proclaiming the good news of what? The kingdom of God that is already present and not yet fulfilled. No longer be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So let's dig into some scriptures about how we get saved. We are going to look at a number of them. Are we saved by faith? Are we saved by works? We saved by faith or we saved by works? Well, let's see what James has to say about that. This is my study Bible, one of them, so it takes me a while to get there. That means it's in very fine print. All right, let's see what James says about faith. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what good is faith? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. But some of you will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will, by my good works, show you my faith. You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Faith, I'm going to jump to verse 26. For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead. Are we saved by faith or are we saved by works? What about James? Doesn't seem to be what James is saying, does it? Let's look at Ephesians. Chapter 2. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing, it is the gift of God. This is verse 8. Not the result of works, so that no one may boast. We are saved by grace through faith, and not by works, so that none can boast. Now James just said works. Paul says in Ephesians, faith. Now that's interesting. Is there a different salvation for men than there is for women? Let's see what Paul has to say about that. How many of us really engage our Bibles? This comes from chapter 2 of 1 Timothy as well. And if we keep reading beyond what we read a moment ago, I desire then that in every place that men should pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. Also that women, the word of God for the people of God. All right. I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. Also that women should dress themselves modestly and decently in suitable clothing, not with their hair braided or with gold, pearls, or expensive clothes, but with good works, as is proper for women to profess reverence for God. Let a woman learn in silence and full submission. I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Yet she shall be saved how? Through childbearing, provided they continue in faith and love and holiness with modesty. Are women saved by faith? By works? Childbearing? What if a woman doesn't have children? What are we going to do about this? The Bible is the sole source of authority for some. How do you reconcile these? Can we reconcile these? Which words are more authoritative? Are there words within Scripture that are more authoritative than others? Are they all authoritative? How do we reconcile that? See, here's what happens. Many of us, I would say all of us, are buffet Scripture readers. We pick out what we want to pick out. We ignore that which we want to ignore. What is the great requirement? What brings the Bible into focus? What's the great requirement? Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with our God. What's the great commandment? Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And what's the next one? Neighbor as yourself. What's the new commandment? To love one another as what? Jesus loves us. How does Jesus love us? Perfect love casts out all fear, the writer of 1 John says. Let's look at that. Who is saved? Who is saved? 1 John, very quickly. My children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin, but if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Who is saved? Who is saved according to this passage? The whole world. But this same writer says this. That was chapter 2, verse 1 through verse 2. Verse 1, chapter 1, verse 5. I'm backing up. This is the message you have heard from him, and we proclaim to you. We have heard from him and proclaim to you that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. Did you catch that? An Aristotelian syllogism, what does that mean? If A is B and B is C, then A is C. So let's try to think through this deductively. If we say we have fellowship with him while we are in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. So if light means to have fellowship with one another, what is darkness? Not to be in fellowship with one another. So if we claim to be in fellowship with him, but not in fellowship with one another, we lie to ourselves. Or we accepted a lie. We heard a lie. We received a lie. We were conditioned by a lie. That if we believe something in a name, we go to heaven, and that has nothing to do with what goes on here. When it had everything to do with what Jesus was up to. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, he said, when he came out of the wilderness, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, recovery of sight to the blind, blinded by the lie that God is out to get you, blinded by a cultural context that has limited your sight of who God is, to set at liberty those who are captive, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord where every debt is canceled. And the people who had to sell land to live on, they get it back. So that everybody has enough. This is what I would submit to you. And this is where many of you will disagree with me, and that's okay, because we're a disciples congregation, and we encourage people to think and not to agree with whoever's talking the loudest through a microphone. In an objective sense, you are saved. God loves you more than you will ever, ever comprehend in this lifetime. And yet, we need to continue to get saved. We are saved in an objective sense, but we are called to actualize it, to manifest it, to grow into it, to embody it as Jesus did. God is love, unconditional, infinite love. There's no beginning, there's no end. Unconditional means unconditional. So many people say God's love is unconditional, and immediately they'll start giving you conditions. God's love is absolutely unconditional. That is the truth with a capital T. That is reality with a capital R. That is God with a capital G. God's love is absolutely infinite, unconditional, never ending. It doesn't start one day and end another. It always was, always will be. It is yours to receive. Once we get that, we are saved. I remember a day that I got saved in one sense, that I got it, that God loves me. I don't have to be afraid anymore. And then the transformation takes place. Then we become what we already are, what we were always intended to be, who we truly are. And that's the reason we have to have in us the mind of Christ, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be clung to or grasped at, the status, the rank. He emptied himself of status, rank, privilege. Took on human form, took the very lowest status, so that the very lowest status now has the highest status, divine. No human being is inferior to another. We are all children of God. God is love. Jesus is the embodiment of love. He'll say it, proclaim it, sacrifice, teach, die, and rise again. Jesus reveals who we are. Jesus is the Son of God. We are sons and daughters of God. Something got marred along the way, distorted. Jesus, by looking at him, shows us who we are. And when we recognize that, when we confess not just a name, but the one who was named that, when we recognize that, when we become that, we are saved and this world is transformed. Now let me say this, because this is important. This is why, to a large degree, churches still need to get saved. We don't get it. We still don't get it. That's the reason we have predominantly white churches and black churches and rich churches and poor churches and educated churches and uneducated churches. Latinx churches. Churches where some people are welcome here and not there. We still need to get saved. You see, Jesus didn't have to worry about who he identified with. He could identify with anyone. He wasn't afraid of how that would reflect on him. He knew who he was. A son of God. A child of God. And this is what is frustrating me at this point. And you hear my anger coming out, but I'm frustrated. Why is loving people so controversial? Think about it. Think about the pressure some of our families place on us because now we love some people that they thought were out of bounds. Right? God's love gets a hold of us, and now we love people that we were told you weren't supposed to love because of this, that, or the other. Why is love so controversial? Why is it so difficult for us? Because we're afraid. My prayer for us this morning is that we will recognize that we are saved in an objective sense. God loves us more than we can possibly begin to comprehend. God's love for us is never going to end. And yet, we still need to get saved. We need to get it. We need to embody it. We need to grow in it. We need to reach out with it. We need to love those that somebody somewhere with good intentions, quoting scripture, said was out of bounds. Let me say this. I'm going to tell a quick story very quickly because this is the importance of it. I had no response ability to get saved in the sense that we often talk about people getting saved. This week, it was mentioned to me that there was a person. I disclosed a story a few months ago, and a couple came to me and said that there's a young man in prison who, after his third DUI, was in an automobile accident that took the life of another person. Do I have your attention? And wanted to know if I would write him a letter. And of course, immediately I said, yes, I will, but it's taken me months to write it. Because what can I say to him? How do you think he feels? What pain somewhere was he in that he was anesthetizing himself, medicating himself? I have a picture of him on my desk. I've never met him, never spoken to him. What can I say to him? Where has the church been? This is where we need to get saved. Where has the church been that if someone has an addiction, maybe they're afraid to go there? If someone has a history with something, they're afraid to go there. We need to get saved in the sense of how many tragedies could we prevent if we loved people the way Jesus loves us? It's not just about our souls, it's about people's very lives. Lives that are lost in accidents, lives that are wasted in a prison cell. And it's people who loved me unconditionally when I didn't know love and didn't deserve it. When I deserved, I thought, a punishment. That's what helps us grow. That's what opens the door, because people can't know. Paul writes in Romans, how can they know if they've not heard? People get saved by this message of love when we're willing to love them, when they least deserve it in the sense we think they do, but because they deserve it, because God says they deserve it, because God loves them. We love because God loves. Everybody deserves to be loved because God says they deserve to be loved. And when we have that love, our world is saved. We are saved. The church is saved. So that's my prayer for you and for me. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're able. There's anyone here this morning who has never made a confession of faith. Jesus really is the way, the truth, and the life. His way is the way of love. His truth is the truth of love. His life is the life of love. There's anyone who is not a part of a community of faith, who is welcome here, church? Many people in this room don't agree with a thing I've said this morning, and they still welcome me here every week. If you don't agree with the thing I just said, you are welcome here, absolutely. No one will impose a thought on you. No one will impose an interpretation of Scripture on you. We will defend your right to your reading of Scripture. We just won't defend your right to impose it on someone else. Because we mean everybody is welcome. You are free to live within your conscience here. You are equal. You have equal opportunity to grow in your faith. Everyone is treated with justice, which means everyone is due dignity and respect. Everyone. If you're looking for that kind of community of faith, if you want to grow in what that means, if you want to grow in your salvation that's already yours, we do that in community, and you're invited to do so. If you want to recommit your life, you're welcome to come do so up front, or you're welcome to do it right where you stand. But I invite you to respond as God is calling to you to respond as we sing our song of commitment.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore.
And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, the peace that comes from knowing neither height nor depth nor things present nor things to come nor angels nor powers nor nothing in anything in creation, nothing can separate us from the love of God revealed in Christ Jesus. May that peace guard and sustain our hearts this day and forevermore. Amen.